Hi, I'm Miguel. Welcome to Viana do Castelo, where we are developing the wave energy of the future.
Miguel, welcome to Enlit on the Road. Thank you for having us. Let's start by finding out, why is Portugal the perfect place to develop your technology?
Portugal has an historic relation with the wave energy. It started way back in the 70s. So we choose Portugal because there was a site where there is a tradition for testing wave energy devices. And it's a site that we can call it, make it or break it. So if your device is tested in that site and it survives and it yields the power that you're announcing, it will be a win. That site is in Agustadora. It sits around about 20 kilometers to the south from Viana do Castelo. In that site, there were the conditions that allowed us to have the proper framework to develop the tests. That framework is not only physical, but also legal, and it had a link to the community already. There's basically a very positive ecosystem where this kind of work can be done. We decided to sit our base here in Viana do Castelo because we had a huge support from the local municipality. We have wind float just 18 kilometers from shore that went through this process also. They tested their scaled model in Agustadora for 5 years, with a huge success, and from there they gave the next step for pre-commercial. And this is the path that we want to emulate.
Miguel, there are so many renewable sources, especially here in Portugal. What makes wave energy important and relevant?
Yeah, wave energy has a critical contribution to a 24/7 renewable energy system because of its complementary profile. So it complements wind and it complements solar. If we mix them all together in the production profile, you have a stable production profile that you can offer to, for example, electric intensive consumers, steel electrolyzers and so on. So the uniqueness of wave is the base load type of profile that is very stable and gives reassurance to the grid. What we are doing in Portugal is the stage four of a larger program that's started in Sweden with our colleagues in Scotland, in Norway. So in Portugal, we are doing the real scale installation. We tested the C4, that's the stage four machine that you see behind us, with huge success last year, overcoming big challenges. And that's one of the steps for the future. And this step has already had an impact in marine energy. So finally, there is a wave device that can survive the sea and that can generate the power that we announced it can generate.
These are great results for Portugal, but obviously this is very meaningful for the marine energy sector at large, I mean, within Europe and perhaps the globe. How is it making an impact?
If we think about the ocean as a large battery, it's the first time that we are tapping efficiently to that power source. Of course, floating offshore wind is looking at us to the possibility of hybridizing on a co-location perspective. So improving their power output and their production profile. As it's now a thing because the turbines are bigger. The space they need in the ocean is getting also bigger. And in between those turbines, there's a lot of space not used. So co-location with wave becomes one of the options for the floating offshore wind promoters and then developers to maximize the existing space and to obtain a better production profile from that wind farm. This gives security to the grid, less installations, less investments on grid, and this is a pivot point for marine energy in the future. For now it's co-location, but I think that with time people will understand that even without floating offshore wind, you have a great business case for wave energy. So you have 24/7 energy coming because fortunately, we have always wave in the ocean. And this will come later with the maturity of the technology and the proof that it still has to do in the ocean. Wind float is there for several years and people still think it's not mature enough. And it's given all the proofs that you want, right? So technology to be perceived as safe for investment needs time in the ocean and needs to yield what it promises. As any emergent technology, we need time, in our case, volume, number of units, to get it to the right cost level and to compete for the same financing lines at the banks or institutions as solar and wind is doing right now.
You touched on it briefly, but there's been some unique developments with your device, and especially in terms of survivability, energy efficiency. Give us some more information about that.
We have been striving for that result, to be able to survive the harsh conditions of the sea and also to have a very cost-efficient device. That was proven last year in November during the four storms that we got here in Portugal, where our survivability technology was tested and yield very positive results. The design from the device and the concept behind it, it has always LCOE as the main metric, so the levelized cost of electricity. So when you design the machine and each of its components, you're thinking about the levelized cost of energy. So for example, on the C4 that you see behind us, you have a composite hull. It's a choice for LCOE. It's a choice that moved us away from traditional hulls of steel that are very vulnerable to raw material price fluctuations. And we moved to a high efficiency, mostly fully automated process to manufacture cut from resin and fiberglass. So this immediately gave us a 70% reduction on LCOE. So this is an example how the design is tuned by a metric that is feeding to the one of the big targets that has to have a competitive technology in the market. From the technology perspective, we have proven survivability. I think that's the number one thing that everybody wanted to see, because the some of the devices in the past have just not been able to survive. And this survivability mode is accomplished by a system that we call wave springs, that allows the buoy to be tuned or detuned to the incoming wave. So when we have waves above 8 meters, it gets detuned and it gets into a transparent mode. That transparent mode is the wave energy version of the pitch system from the wind turbine. So whenever you have high winds, the turbines will pitch and the wind will go through the blades without interfering with the blades. So this means when you design the buoy, you don't design it for the worst case scenario, for the biggest waves. So the buoy does not need to be working on the smaller and the biggest wave. And when the storm or the big waves are gone, it just gets back online and starts generating power again. So we survived four storms with waves close to 19 meters high, several days with waves above 8 meters, just pounding and pounding on the device. And then we also proved power production, because we were injecting power to the national grid here in Portugal for the first time. And we also proved that all the models that we have been using to evaluate, to design, to predict, were highly, highly accurate.
Miguel, it's obviously been quite a long road to get to this point. Talk to me a little bit about some of the lessons that you've learned. Marine energy in general is quite a nascent sector. So how have you really approached this, and share with us the lessons you've learned from this process?
I think the most important thing for CorPower was to be working from the beginning on a very structured way. So you don't go from one TRL point to the other without proving that you have checked all boxes in the previous TRL level. So this is what we have been doing since 2012. That's one of the secrets. Also, very important is to have the public engagement, not only from the possible customers, academia, companies, but fishermen, local communities, engaged in these kinds of projects to make it happen properly. If we don't find the right solution in the market, we stop and think about the right solution for the LCOE target. From step to step, very structurally approaching all the issues that come up, turning that into an opportunity by solving the problem. When we thought about the mooring system, there were the anchors in the market were very expensive. So the company decided, okay, let's stop and think, let's do our own anchor system. We have always a collaborative approach where we work with private sector and with academia all together. And we got this very nice universal mooring anchor that will be a solution for wave energy, but also for other markets. For example, floating offshore wind. And all these are wins for the technology and also for the sector. In wave energy, there is still not a winning universal concept. For wind, a turbine is a turbine, right? It's a tower and a cell, a hub and blades. That's the concept. For wave, still not. There's still not a universal concept that can bind all academia and the industrial part of things to really drill down on costs and to work together into, I would say, quasi-universal solution. So maybe there are 80, 90 concepts around and everybody's working on those concepts with, I don't know, hundreds of different approaches. So there are a lot of, it's like a cloud of points, and there's nothing, there's no cluster around, you know, a single concept. But we are finally noticing, because of the success from CorPower, we have a point absorber type of device with a single leg to the ocean, and it's oscillating vertically and a little bit sideways. And we see now a lot of research, a lot of papers, a lot of studies, and a lot of interest around point absorbers. And this could be the unifying technology for at least offshore wave energy. And this means that more people will be thinking on the same thing. And finally, we have competitors, because we need competitors. Competitors are very important to accelerate the development, to give steps into the future faster.
One final quick question. What's next for you and the team and for CorPower?
Yeah, for CorPower, the next step will be stage 5, where we install 3 machines in Aguçadora, in Povo de Varzim, that's the municipality down to the south, together with a collection hub and the submarine grid. So the target for the stage 5 is to demonstrate the array, the set of devices. And this means that we'll have 4 devices, up to 1.2 megawatts of power installed, and a collection hub. That's equipment that will allow us to plug in all the devices. And then from that point, we have an export cable to land. This will be what we call the core pack. That's a set of devices, and we'll sell them at sets of 5, 10, 30 megawatts, multiples of this. So this is the product that will come. So that's the next step from an experimental perspective. And of course, we are working in parallel in our first pre-commercial wave farm. So the next step after the underwater grid demonstration and proof is to actually go for the first wave farms. Hopefully the first will be here in Portugal or in Ireland. And of course, we are working right now on the commercial wave farms. The message for the investors and the promoters is that it's time now. The time is now to get together with us and prepare the next wave farms for the future.
Miguel, it's been a pleasure. Thank you for sharing your insights.
Thank you.
And for joining Enlit on the road.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
For more insights, join the Enlit community.